I think that one of the most important aspects of the American Chestnut Foundation that I've experienced in the years that I've been involved is the fact that it is a citizen science organization. It engages volunteers like myself, like many of you out there, in doing the work of science, and it brings us in contact with some amazing and wonderful professional scientists. And we probably don't have enough time for me to introduce everybody, but we have in our audience today some people who have given literally their lives to this effort, who've given incredibly generously to those of us who've been volunteers in this operation. And I'm just so grateful that you folks are here, and I hope you young whippersnappers feel appropriately honored that they're here to listen to you and to ask you questions. You want to go ahead, Jared?
Thanks for having me, everyone. So I'm here today to update you on a nearly 90-year effort to restore the American chestnut. So we're going to talk about from 90 years of breeding, where we go using incorporating tools of genomics and biotechnology to accelerate the restoration of the American chestnut. So this is the American chestnut. The reason we're interested in the species is it used to be a keystone species in the eastern forests of the United States. Nearly one in four trees were American chestnut in certain areas of the Appalachian Mountains. The wood was highly prized as for structural timber. I don't know why. And it's lightweight, rot resistant, and the nuts were used as a source of food for wildlife and livestock. And after the decimation of the American chestnut, it's thought that the carrying capacity of eastern forests for wildlife has been reduced significantly, and it's altered the nutrient cycling in the forest as well. So it's a charismatic species that's had the decimation has had a large ecological impact on the functioning of forests in the Appalachian Mountains. So many of you are familiar with the story, but in 1904, the chestnut blight was discovered on trees in the Bronx Zoo in New York. And chestnut blight is caused by a fungus, Trichomnetria parasitica. It infects the bark and disrupts the flow of water up the stem, and that curdles the tree. By 1950, the blight had spread throughout the range of the American chestnut all the way down into Mississippi and Alabama, and has decimated the species. You can see here, this is a shot from Shenandoah National Park, basically showing the extent of the destruction. So today, the American chestnut is functionally extinct. So the stems, luckily the tree is able to resprout prolifically from the roots. And so the stems resprout, and these trees can live on as 10 to 15 years as stump sprouts in the forest. And then they'll typically get the blight and then die back and then resprout again. So there's still trees out there and they're still flowering, and that's what's enabled this breeding program, identifying flowering American chestnuts. And the early breeding programs from the USDA focused on combining the blight resistance of the Asian chestnut species, which evolved resistance to the blight, because this is where the chestnut blight came from, Japan, China. These trees have been bred for nut production. So they're multi-stem species. They tend to be shorter in stature than the American chestnut, single-stem, dominant tree species. So these early breeding programs sought to combine the canopy, or the growth form of the American chestnut with the resistance of the Chinese or the other Asian chestnut species. I don't know why I just keep doing this. So when you create these hybrids, you create these F1 hybrids, they have intermediate blight resistance and they're not competitive in the forest. So by the 1960s, basically, the USDA breeding programs were discontinued. And so the chestnut sort of lived on in obscurity for the next 20 years. And in the 1980s, the idea of reviving, the enthusiasm for reviving the American chestnut was what was kindled again by this man, Charles Burnham. He was a National Academy member. He was a maize geneticist in his retirement. He was reading some papers and he found, and he was familiar with plant breeding techniques, and he knew that you could use this technique called backcrossing to take the traits that are simply inherited and bring them into another genetic background. So, you know, for disease resistance in crop species, they use backcrossing to bring in, you know, resistance into a cultivar that is valuable for agriculture. So he proposed this idea for the American chestnut. Basically, the idea is you take these F1 hybrids of 50% American, 50% Chinese, and you backcross them three times to American chestnut. So you're crossing with American chestnut and having the fraction of the genome that was inherited from Chinese chestnut and increasing the amount of American chestnut genome. So basically, you're recovering trees that are essentially American chestnut, 15th, 16th American chestnut by this third backcross generation. And so these trees are going to look and grow like American chestnut, and if there's only a few genes involved in light resistance in this 5% of the genome that's from Chinese chestnut, then basically you can combine the American chestnut growth form with the resistance of Chinese chestnut. And in order to enhance resistance further, you take these trees that you select for resistance in the backcross generations and you intercross them so they can potentially inherit genes from both mom and dad for resistance to the chestnut blight. So I'm going to be using these terms like B3F2 through the top. B3 refers to third backcross generation. B3F2 refers to intercrossing these trees and generating progeny from intercrosses. So this whole backcross breeding program was initiated and implemented by Fred Hebert starting in 1989. Fred's here in the audience with us. And he took these trees that were created by this USDA and Connecticut agriculture breeding programs, and they're called the Clapper and Graves trees, they're first backcross trees, and he identified American chestnuts flowering in the forests in Virginia, and he crossed them with these Clapper and Graves trees. These Clapper and Graves trees have descended from different Chinese chestnut parents, so they potentially have different genes for resistance. And so he every one of these crosses, he generated about 100 individuals. He inoculated with the farm staff at Meadowview, Virginia, inoculated these trees and selected only five from every one of these families of 100 individuals. And then he took those five individuals and then crossed them with another set of Americans to create these backcross lines. And the purpose was to capture some genetic diversity from the species. And when you do the intercrossing, you want to avoid inbreeding. You don't want to use just one line of American chestnut because the tree needs to breed with trees that are distantly related. So this has since been expanded from Meadowview, Virginia breeding program to state chapter programs that are run by volunteers primarily, and they've taken pollen from Meadowview, the trees that we select for resistance, and they've crossed them with trees that flowering American chestnut that they've identified throughout the range of the species. So we have 14 different breeding programs that are different chapters of the American Chestnut Foundation. And they've basically, for these Clapper and Graves sources of resistance, they've created roughly 400 backcross lines. So it's capturing some diversity and, you know, providing a founder population for restoration of the species and local adaptation to whatever climates from Maine all the way down into Alabama. So some basic genetics here. In backcross generations, you're crossing American chestnut, which is susceptible to the blight, with a hybrid that has some resistance. So at best, you're going every location in the genome, these A, B, C, these letters represent different locations in the genome that control resistance. And at best, you're going to, at every location in the genome, at best, you're going to inherit one gene for susceptibility from American chestnut, depicted by the small a, and one gene for resistance from Chinese chestnut, depicted by the large letters. So these trees are expected to be intermediate in resistance between Chinese and American chestnut. And that's exactly what we see when we look at the cankers. These are average canker sizes of American chestnut, average canker sizes of Chinese chestnut. And this is the F1 hybrids, 50% American, 50% Chinese. And we see that these second backcross trees that were selected and the third backcross trees that were selected have intermediate resistance between Chinese and American chestnut and equivalent resistance to the F1 hybrids. So in order to, I know this is a lot of letters here, but in order to to enhance resistance further, you have to take these trees that are heterozygous, meaning they are, you know, have one gene for resistance and one gene for susceptibility at every locus, cross them together, and you generate these populations that have this whole spectrum of resistance, varying from having zero genes for resistance and basically inheriting all genes for susceptibility from American chestnut, all the way through inheriting two copies of every gene for resistance from Chinese chestnut. And so we have to screen through many, many individuals to make one selection. We're expecting one out of 64 trees, there's only three genes that control resistance. One out of 64 trees is going to be as resistant as Chinese chestnut. This is the targeted selection. And not every tree we plant in the ground is going to survive to the inoculation age. So we have to plant out more than the 64 trees for every one that we're going to make a selection for. So we end up with this massive issue of problem of selection. So we have to plant each back cross line in 9 blocks to basically capture the diversity of American chestnut in for that each that line. And then we plant out 150 trees per line in each block. And then we're aiming to select one of the most blight resistant trees for every 150 trees. So if we're talking about a seed orchard composed of 20 back cross lines planted in 9 blocks, we're talking about planting 30,000 trees. And we're going to select 250 from those 30,000. So we're talking about 1%. We're going to kill 99%, select 1%. So they're planted in these like seed orchards, 1 foot spacing. And so it's a massive job to be able to inoculate and do selection in these orchards. And so there's been this initial selection against susceptibility in the seed orchards. Basically what's been done is you inoculate trees at age 2 with a slightly pathogenic strain of the blight, and we have uprooted trees that have any canker expansion that's moderate or severe. And we only leave trees that have the smallest cankers. So based on this selection, it's called phenotypic selection, you know, against trees that are susceptible, we kill about 80 to 90% of the population that rogue those trees out based on their canker phenotypes. So we're left with, we go down from 30,000 down to 5,000 or 3,000. We're trying to get to 250. So to be able to get to the 250, we've started to do this procedure called progeny testing. To actually infer, we can't tell the difference in resistance between these trees with the small cankers. But there is resistance there. It just, not, we can't see it with our eye. So we've been planting out the progeny of these trees in a test, and we inoculate all of the progeny of these trees, and look at the average canker severity of these progeny for all of these different parents that remain in the seed orchard. And that's how we infer the level of genetic resistance from the parents in the seed orchard, is from the base to the average resistance in the progeny. So it's a long process to be able to distinguish the resistance and make the final selection between seed orchards. And what we're finding after doing this progeny testing, this is the range in family means for canker severity. And this, I scaled this for 100 being the canker severity of American chestnut, 0 being the average canker of Chinese chestnut families. And what we're seeing is that we've progeny tested about 600 families. This is what these box plots represent, the range of variation in canker severity. And given that we've selected about 80 to 90% of the population we've selected against them, we're expecting to find trees that have canker severity somewhere near Chinese chestnut. But in fact, we're finding that their canker severity is more similar to American than Chinese chestnut. So we have less resistance than expected in the population. And we're expected that after we do the selection, these trees are going to be about halfway, have the resistance about halfway in between Chinese and American chestnut. So that's a surprising result, and why might that be? Why are these trees less resistant than Chinese chestnut? The idea in the breeding program initially was that when we're doing selection, we're always going to be selecting for the same genes from Chinese chestnut in every back cross line. And that's what this scenario is representing. We have 3 genes. Every back cross line is going to inherit the same number of genes. And there's going to be no variation in resistance, and we're going to recover the full resistance of Chinese chestnut. What in fact we're probably seeing is that these American bat, there's more than three genes involved in resistance, and these American bat cross lines might have inherited different subsets of the genes. So they're, you know, A, B, C, D, E, F. We don't know exactly how many genes are involved at this point. And so when you do the intercrossing, they're not going to inherit the full set of genes, and they're going to be less resistant than Chinese chestnut. And the other thing that may be hampering our progress is that gains in resistance are proportional to selection accuracy. So one of the first things that you learn in the Genetics 101 course is that the phenotype, which is like human height or canker size or whatever we're interested in, whatever phenomenon we're interested in, is a function of the underlying genes controlling a trait in environmental variables. So with chestnut blight, it might be competition between neighboring trees. It might be which microorganisms are living in the cankers, which will affect the progression of the disease. So if there's a large environmental effect, it's going to make a weak correlation between what we observe, the phenotypic resistance, and what the actual genetic resistance of the population is. So in this cartoon, I've shown that, you know, if we do the selection, then this is like a population where we basically are killing 99% of the population and leaving this 1% in this area. If we have a low accuracy selection, our gains, the average canker severity of the selected individuals, is going to be less than if we have very accurate selection. So if we have a high correlation between what we observe and the total resistance. So this is showing the very accurate selection. You can see that the resistance depicted by this dotted dashed line is higher than if you have low accuracy selection. So we may be having, you know, a large effect of environment on the development of cankers, which is hampering our overall gains in resistance. And then progeny testing itself is too slow to meaningfully collect data to contribute to selection in seed orchards. So we whittled our population down from about 60,000 trees in the Clapper Grave seed orchards down to over 10,000 trees now. And we have, in the past 7 years, we've progeny tested, through a lot of effort, we've progeny tested about 700 individuals, 600, 700 individuals. So we have to get, the number of trees that remain after phenotypic selection is much greater than the number of trees that can possibly progeny test. So one potential way out of this challenge here is to increase the speed and accuracy of selection. And one idea is to take, use regional screening centers to basically grow up containerized seedlings. We could potentially do this in Meadowview. We already have the capacity to do it at our farm in Meadowview, potentially at Virginia Tech, and also at University of Tennessee in Chattanooga. We're testing out these early screening methods. So we grow these chestnuts in pots, and then we inoculate the seedlings, or we use some other method, like what Anna's gonna present on. This is a non-destructive method to basically eliminate more than half of the individuals before we even plant them. So like, we're not growing them out in the field. We're just going to eliminate the susceptible individuals, and we'll have a remaining population that's a much more manageable size that we can plant out in the seed orchard at wider spacing. And then we use a genomic selection model I'll explain this in a little bit, and Jason will get into further detail, to make the final selections. So rather than progeny testing every tree, the idea with genomic selection is that we can extract DNA from a leaf and infer the resistance, predict the resistance, just based on the DNA sequence. We don't have to wait for the trees in the field to grow. We can just get a leaf and predict the resistance. And should speed up the selection process and hopefully increase the accuracy as well. So the idea with the phenotypic selection is we have this whole spectrum of resistance from American to Chinese chestnut. We would basically eliminate all of these low and average performing trees before we even plant them. We'd only plant the higher performing trees in the field. And we could use a small stem assay, like grow, you know, seedlings in their first year, inoculate the seedlings. And we can tell the difference between Chinese chestnut and American chestnut canker growth. So we've been able to see that, you know, this is potentially a way that we can pick out trees that have resistance or canker sizes more similar to Chinese chestnut. The other thing that Anna's going to talk about is this non-destructive method called infrared spectroscopy, where you pass light through a stem tissue, and if there's specific metabolites in the stem that are correlated in some way with resistance, then the absorbance of light will be correlated with the metabolite concentration, which is then correlated with resistance. So you can predict resistance based on this spectrum of absorbance. And that's great because you don't have to inoculate seedlings that are, you know, potentially killing many trees that even Chinese chestnut that might be, like, the Chinese chestnut may not be able to even survive some of the inoculations that we do with seedlings. So this is a non-destructive way and potentially gets these trees growing faster in the field without having to kill them. So basically the idea is fewer trees planted, less competition. So, you know, rather than planting at 1 foot spacing, we plant at wider spacing in a seed orchard, and we allow those trees with moderate resistance to grow up, and then we make the final selections with genomic selection. And genomic selection, the idea is we know this variation in spectrum of resistance that we can see from our progeny testing and from inoculations in the field. So we know like the resistance differences in canker sizes among all of these families. And so we genotype these trees with a genome-wide panel of genetic markers. So basically what we're doing is we're taking the genome, we're cutting it to bits with restriction enzymes, and then we're sequencing DNA around the restriction enzyme sites randomly. So we're randomly determining at different locations in the genome where there's DNA sequence variants. And by chance, these markers in the genetic map are going to be close in proximity to a gene involved in disease resistance. And so those markers that are close to disease resistance genes should be predictive of the resistance. So we can see that the DNA sequence is somehow correlated with resistance, and we can use that to predict resistance by so we need to be able to develop a genomic prediction model, which Jason will talk more about how we're doing that. And so in order to develop a genomic prediction model, we need to be able to first assay the population and find out variation in resistance in the population among many different families of trees to accurately estimate the effects of genetic markers. And so we're waiting on trees now. So we have to, you know, grow this. What this graph is showing is we need to be able to test about 500 different families within each source of resistance to get accurate genomic selection. And this is showing the progress of our progeny testing from 2011 to 2020. So it's going to take us to about 2020 to be able to genotype and phenotype all of these 500 families that are to develop these accurate genomic selection models. So that's what we're doing right now, is growing these trees and screening families, and Jason is doing some genotyping and starting to develop these prediction models for resistance. And I did this simulation where we looked at gains in blight resistance using different scenarios for selection, where we did selection based on 100% just canker phenotypes, where we did 90% canker phenotypes and 10% progeny testing. And then this final scenario in blue, where we did 90% phenotype, 2% progeny testing, 8% of the population genomic selection. And we're looking at, you know, the gains from selection over time, both gain, absolute gain, and gain for time. And genomic selection is predicted to have a lot of more gains in efficiency per unit time relative to these other methods. Phenotypic selection is limited by its accuracy. Progeny testing is limited by the slowness of growing trees. So the take-home message here is that we're going to save a lot of time and potentially have more accurate selection with genomic selection, which lead to more resistant trees sooner. And I'll leave it at that for now for Jason or for Anna to talk about the early screen.
My name is Anna Conrad. I'm a postdoc
at the University of Kentucky. I work at the Forest Health Research and Education Center, which is housed in the Forestry Department there. So today I'm going to touch briefly on plant chemicals and how they can fit in with screening for resistance in trees. Talk about and introduce the term chemical fingerprinting and some of the methods that we use to chemical fingerprint trees. And then finally, talk about how we are evaluating chemical fingerprinting in chestnut as a method to potentially screen trees for disease resistance. So all trees, including chestnut, contain plant chemicals or phytochemicals. These chemicals play many different roles in the trees. They could play structural roles. They could be important for helping trees protect themselves against UV light. And from my perspective, importantly and very interesting is the role of these chemicals in plant responses to different stresses, both biotic, so pests and pathogens, but also abiotic stresses like drought stress, for instance. The chemical composition, so this includes the exact chemicals that are present within a tree or any plant for that matter, and also the concentration of those chemicals are going to be species dependent, and there may even be variability within a species or within a hybrid. As I mentioned, stress can impact the amount and the types of chemicals that are produced by trees, such that you have a suite of chemicals, also known as constitutive chemicals, that are produced kind of before that stress event, and then induced chemicals, so those that would be produced after a stress event, like being attacked by chestnut blight. For the focus of this talk, we focus exclusively on those chemicals that are constitutively present, so always present before the stress. And as Jared mentioned, in some instances we can use chemicals as markers for specific traits like disease resistance. So chemicals as markers of disease resistance. These chemicals are not necessarily the reason why the trees are resistant or susceptible to a given stress, like a pathogen. However, they may be correlated with that resistance or that susceptibility. So there's many instances where there is evidence to suggest that chemicals play a direct role in defense responses. However, that isn't our motivation with testing this technique necessarily, but in chestnut. But so we're saying it could be correlated, not necessarily causation, but that of course is not to say that chemicals don't play some role in the tree defense response. Using the chemical composition of a tree, like chestnut, seedling, stem tissue, or leaf tissue, we can attempt to develop models that will allow us to predict whether or not a tree would be resistant or susceptible to a given pathogen or pest. And this is based on the chemicals that are present. So both the composition of chemicals, so all those individual chemicals, but then also the amount of those chemicals that are present in the trees. This is tissue specific. So there's going to be a different, possibly different chemicals that are present in the leaves versus the bark versus the roots. This may also be time dependent. So what time of year are we interested, or what time of year are we sampling the trees? Is it the fall? Is it the spring? If you sample the chemicals in any tree leaf now in the fall and you sample it in the summer, it's probably going to be different, right? The color is changing, so we're having some changes in the chemical composition. So those are important factors that we need to take into effect when we try to evaluate and also develop these models to predict tree resistance or susceptibility based on the chemical composition. And most importantly, we need to have robust and reliable phenotypic data. So Jared mentioned all the different types of phenotypic screening in his talk, so looking at lesion length or blight rating, and many of you are probably familiar with what a diseased chestnut looks like out in nature. So having a lot of phenotypic data that you trust, so I'm saying I can reliably say this tree is resistant, or this tree is susceptible, or this tree is somewhere in the middle, perhaps relative to the susceptibility of Chinese chestnut or American chestnut, is very important. because initially we need that phenotypic data and we need to be able to compare it to the chemical data so we can look for the connections between those two sets of data. And so if we don't have robust and reliable phenotypic data, there's a chance that we could create these models that are maybe not very accurate. So next we'll talk about, I'll talk about chemical fingerprinting. So what is chemical fingerprinting? Chemical fingerprinting is essentially a comprehensive analysis of all the chemicals that are present within a given sample. So in chemical fingerprinting, compared to some other more specific techniques, we don't necessarily separate out the chemicals. So we're not saying we have chemical A, B, C, D, and G. We're just saying we have a whole bunch of chemicals present within our sample. We're more interested in how they all come together rather than what the individual identities of them are. This essentially provides us then a snapshot of the chemical composition of a given tissue at a given time. So like I said, it's time dependent but also tissue dependent. And so I made a picture very pixelated because this serves as a good example of essentially what we're doing. So here's our chemical snapshot, let's say of a chestnut leaf. And within that snapshot, there's going to be a lot of individual components, chemical components, and little pixels in a snapshot, an actual snapshot picture that we take. And so we're essentially looking at all of those different pixels and trying to determine which of those pixels and how many of those pixels are going to allow us to predict light resistance, for instance, or whatever trait it is that we're interested in. So there's several benefits of chemical fingerprinting. This provides the potential for more rapid screening for disease resistance, as Jared mentioned earlier. When you take historical or normal methods for Flint disease screening, it may take weeks or months or even years to determine whether or not a tree is resistant or susceptible. However, when you use chemical fingerprinting and assuming you have a nice, reliable and robust predictive model, you can analyze an extract from plant tissue in a matter of 5 minutes or less. So if you compare a few minutes or maybe a couple of days of a few minutes of work, so 10 to 15 minutes, you could know whether or not a tree is likely to be resistant or susceptible. Of course, it takes that's an oversimplified, but if you think of it in the scheme of things, it's much more rapid. As Jared also mentioned, it's relatively, it's non-destructive. So we don't need to necessarily inoculate trees with a pathogen to be able to gauge their resistance or susceptibility. And in fact, there's even some techniques available that would allow you to actually analyze an intact plant. So I have this pointer in my hand, so maybe 5 times bigger, go up to a plant, push a button, and then on my screen it pops up with some data. And then I can plug that data into my computer and say, okay, that tree is likely to be resistant, or that tree is likely to be susceptible. Of course, that's an ideal scenario. We're not to that point yet. But that's the potential of this technique. Where I think this technique would fit well within the current Chestnut program is that it can facilitate those methods that are already being employed, like Jared mentioned. Use this kind of as a pre-screen, so let's weed out the most susceptible individuals and only focus on those that are likely to be resistant. So Jared mentioned infrared spectroscopy. And so specifically, I've been testing a form of infrared spectroscopy called Fourier Transform Infrared Spectroscopy, or FTIR. I'll just use FTIR for short for the remainder of this talk. And so this is one method of chemical fingerprinting. In this method, we focus on the mid-infrared spectrum. So we have UV light, which we know is really bad for our skin, and radio waves, which bring us NPR and other good programs in our car radios. And then the infrared is somewhere in the middle. So we focus on the mid-infrared region specifically because it's known to be very good for fingerprinting. You can get usually good resolution of chemicals and allow you to identify actually individual chemical groups present within samples using that region. So talking about it more specifically, so we're measuring how a sample absorbs light over a wide spectral window. So the mid-infrared spectrum runs between approximately 700 to 4,000 wave numbers, which is a unit that is essentially an inverse wavelength. So think of thousands of data points essentially that you're collecting. And so using an FTIR spectrometer, so it's that specific instrument, we can actually collect data from each of those little points in the mid-infrared window. And so this allows that differences in the chemical composition or the concentration of those chemicals within our plant tissue or extract will actually affect the FTIR spectrum that we collect. And this is just a simplistic look of kind of how we would collect those samples. So this blue is a crystal. It's very small. And this green represents our sample. In this case, we're pretending this is a small film, so essentially like millimeters in thickness. You couldn't even measure it. And we use an infrared beam of light, and that reflects off the sample, and out this way comes our data, our FTIR spectrum. So there's several different types of instruments that are available. And I talked about, oh, it could take minutes. You could stick your little instrument up to a tree. This would be an example of that type of instrument. I've never gotten to use one of them. I've heard they're really cool. They're also pretty expensive, so I can't pay for that on my postdoc salary. But the type of instrument I've been using for this work is called a benchtop spectrometer. So this is something you'd find in a laboratory environment. And you can analyze liquid samples like plant extracts and water, or we've been using an organic solvent called methanol. You can also analyze solid, so like ground tissue or pieces of twig, potentially, but we haven't tested that yet. And this is kind of the intermediate option. I call it portable because you can carry it around in a little briefcase. But really, this would be, if you wanted to do an in-field analysis, you would want to work with this type of instrument to see if something like that would be possible. So using either one of those instruments, we're going to be able to collect our FTIR spectrum or our chemical fingerprint. So this is what the data looks like raw when it comes out off of the instrument. And so we're specifically interested in this region, and that's because we find a lot of plant chemicals in that region of the spectrum. So talked briefly about chemical fingerprinting and some of the different types of instruments that we can use for that. And now I'm going to talk about what we've been doing, evaluating chemical fingerprinting as an early screening tool in Chestnut. So the goal of this research, which started about a year ago actually, when I started my postdoc at University of Kentucky, is to evaluate whether or not chemical fingerprinting can be used to screen hybrid chestnut for disease resistance. We're interested specifically in seeing if the technique can be used to screen hybrids for resistance to chestnut blight and also Phytophthora root rot. And at this stage, we've only been evaluated a relatively small number of seedlings and compared to the hundreds of families that Jared mentioned previously. I'm excited to share with you the results that we've generated thus far. And the ability to test this method is only made possible because of collaborators like Jared from the Chestnut Foundation, who provided us with material that had been screened for blight resistance, but also we were able to get some material from a previous study looking at the genetics of Phytophthora root rot resistance in chestnut, and that was a study involving Tatiana Selig. I'm Thank you, Paul. Paul Sisko, Steve Jeffers from Clemson University, Joe James from Chestnut Return Farm, Bert Abbott, who's my supervisor, and Dana Nelson, who's also at Forest Health Center. So this was a project they had done. I was fortunate enough to be able to test some of their tissue and use some of their phenotypic data that had been collected. So I talked about earlier in the presentation that we're focused specifically on the constitutive or those chemicals that are present before a tree ever becomes infected. And this is because if we want to potentially eliminate the need to inoculate a subset of the seedlings, we want to see if the method works in trees that are not yet infected. So we focused on that, and we've been chemically fingerprinting extracts from either stem tissue or leaf tissue from seedlings that are like 0 to 1, so less than 1 year old. And the central question was, can chemical fingerprints collected before infection be used to predict which trees will be resistant or susceptible to chestnut blight or bicopter or root rot? And so with the chestnut blight assay, this was tissue that Jared had collected from a small stem inoculation experiment that he performed in 2015. The tissue was collected before the seedlings were inoculated with blight. And this is an example of one of the seedlings inoculated with the pathogen. And he provided us with the phenotypic data. So this included the lesion length 5 weeks after the seedling was infected with Cryphonectria, and then the blight rating. So this went from 1, 2, or 3, with 1 being less susceptible and 3 being more susceptible. And so what we did is we evaluated whether the stem tissue extracts from American and Chinese chestnut seedlings could be distinguished. So is our technique sensitive? But we can't distinguish between different species, and maybe we need to go back to starting board and reassess the specific method that we're using. And then we evaluated stem tissue extracts from 21 B3F3 families. And finally developed statistical models to essentially try and discriminate, to separate between trees that were more susceptible versus those that were less susceptible. And so this represents some of the results that we got from our analysis comparing American and Chinese chestnut. And so as expected, the chemical fingerprints of American and Chinese chestnut were different, and we're able to use that chemical data to actually develop a mathematical model that would allow us to predict whether or not a tree would be American or Chinese chestnut. And so this is a representative output from some of the analysis that we do. And this output is important because it allows us to essentially tell if an unknown sample would be classified in one of the groups that we're interested in or not. And so, walking you through the plot. So if we had an unknown sample and we're interested in predicting whether it was American or Chinese, or let's say resistant or susceptible to blight, if it plotted within this quadrant, in this instance, it was would be classified as American chestnut. Whereas if it would be in this quadrant, then our model, predictive model based on the chemical fingerprint data, wouldn't be able to tell us whether or not that tree was American or Chinese chestnut in this case, or resistant or susceptible. If it's in this quadrant, then that sample would always be classified as Chinese chestnut or resistant or susceptible. And if it's in this final quadrant, our model wouldn't be able to say with exact certainty whether or not it's American or Chinese in this case. But depending on the sample's proximity to these two quadrants, you could say, well, it's probably going to be one of the two groups. And so what we can tell from our analysis of chemical fingerprint analysis of American Chinese chestnut, that this technique is, at least with this limited sample size, able to clearly differentiate or discriminate between the two species, and that we get 100% of our samples in each group correctly classified. So this would be an ideal example, and hopefully someday maybe we can have a model like this for the hybrid chestnut. So now moving on to the analysis that we did with the hybrid chestnut. I mentioned that we need to have reliable and robust phenotypic data. That's crucial. And so part of that, we also need to have phenotypic variation. So if we don't have any differences in phenotypes, so if they all have the same lesion length or they all have the same blight rating, well, chemical fingerprinting won't be really useful probably. So this demonstrates in the data set that I'll show you just in a moment that we did have differences in susceptibility of hybrid chestnut. This is from within, I call it a clapper data set. So these trees were derived from that clapper Bacross first generation tree. And so there's differences in susceptibility both in the blight rating but also in the lesion length measured 5 weeks after inoculation. And so back to this spectra, the chemical fingerprint, we focus specifically on this region here in the blue box. And we did a little bit of tweaking. We did something called transformation. This essentially allows us to take these big giant peaks and make them into so many smaller peaks. So it gives us some more clarity. And using that, we're able to develop a statistical or mathematical model that allowed us to predict or estimate the length, lesion length of Carbonectria parasitica on these hybrid chestnut seedlings, predicted based on the chemical fingerprint that we measured. And so we have the measured lesion length here, so that's what Jared measured in the field, and then what our chemical fingerprint data and our mathematical model predicted that it would be. So the colors correspond to different blight ratings. For this analysis, we actually focused exclusively on lesion length, but I have the different colors and to show you that there is a, you know, a relationship. We see that our model predicts blight rating 1 to be having a smaller lesion length, which is what we observed in the phenotypic data. And there's some variability within the intermediate group and blight rating group number 3, but that's usually to be expected. Sometimes that intermediate group is difficult to resolve, so oftentimes we'll actually focus on the extremes, so the most susceptible individuals and the most resistant to actually build our model. So if we wanted to use something like this to actually screen or eliminate a subset of the seedlings before they go to be planted in the field, we could say, well, if our model predicts a seedling that has a lesion length of 20 millimeters, then we're going to, 20 millimeters less than, we're going to keep it and we'll throw out the rest. So we're eliminating a good portion of the number of individuals that we potentially need to plant out in the field. So we're also have been doing the same thing for Phytophthora root rot. However, we only have root rot data available, so ratings. And this goes from anywhere from 0 to 3, with 0 being essentially less susceptible or resistant, and 3 being the most susceptible. And we've been evaluating chemical fingerprints to see if we can distinguish between hybrids and two different Bacross first generation families. And so unlike with the chestnut blight assay, we've been analyzing leaf extracts collected in 2014, and what we found so far is that we can't build a chemical fingerprint-based model including both families. So there are differences between families, which is what we also observed for chestnut. We weren't able to build a model for all 21 of the families. We've had to split it up based on their sort of their lineage, either clapper or grays. So we couldn't look at them all together. However, looking at individual families, there's a variation essentially in our ability to discriminate between individuals that are more susceptible versus less susceptible, and that depends on the family. So just to summarize the results of of the work thus far. The results that we've generated thus far are promising. However, we've done it in a relatively limited number of seedlings. So going forward, and if we hope to incorporate this type of screening method in the breeding program, then we need to evaluate a lot more seedlings, specifically focusing on having as many individuals as possible within individual families or perhaps within different clover grapes kind of lineages. We need to evaluate more seedlings, and in the end, we need to make sure that we're creating reliable and robust models that are validated. So what I mean by validated is that we need to test these models on samples that weren't used to generate the model itself. And this is important because if you have a chemical fingerprint-based model to predict blight susceptibility or blight resistance, if you haven't fully tested or validated, there's a chance that you could have erroneous results. And we don't want to throw out chestnut seedlings that may in fact be resistant or chestnut seedlings that are super susceptible, right? So we want to have accurate results if this is part of a pipeline, right? Good in, good out, then that's the phrase. But so with that, there's additional questions that need to be addressed moving forward. And my plan is to continue this work and test the method on more individuals, hybrid seedlings. But one question that would be important to ask is, can we actually take the chemical fingerprint of a chestnut parent and predict the susceptibility of its offspring? That would be really important and very useful. Instead of growing up all those little seedlings, maybe we don't need to. I don't know. We haven't tested it yet. Are there temporal effects on chemical fingerprint? So Jared talked about the fact that the phenotype, so the lesion length or the blight rating, is both on the genes that are present within that individual, but also the environment. So the environment, so the chemical fingerprint is affected both by those genes and by that environment. So it's very important that if we're going to be using this technique, that we sample either at a time, every same time every year, or we sample at a time where we know we're not going to need variation. Because if we have a lot of variation in our chemical fingerprint data, we're not going to be able to create these robust and reliable predictive models based on the chemical fingerprint. And finally, a question that may be important to address would be, can we use these handheld spectrometers? So that red thing that I showed you a picture of earlier. If we can, and if we can build predictive models, then the number of seedlings that we sample, the number of parent trees that we sample would definitely be increased. So it's making it more high throughput. So we'll be able to analyze more individuals in a smaller amount of time. So with that, I mentioned most of the collaborators involved project, also Enrico Bonello and Bruce Rodriguez Sayona, who do this chemical fingerprint work at Ohio State University. And with that, I guess we're doing questions at the end, or yeah. Thank you.
We've just heard a nice talk about predicting phenotypes or trait values on the basis of another phenotype in a way. And I'm going to talk about the same sort of procedure except using genetic data to infer, in this case, blight resistance, but it's more generally something that we can do for any kind of trait or phenotype. So as an evolutionary geneticist, I'm interested in natural variation. And one of the forms of variation that I'm interested in is variation traits that we can observe or infer. And this is ubiquitous across different species and can manifest itself in morphology differences, in differences in physiology, development, and importantly, susceptibility to disease for this crop. And that phenotypic variation is a function, we saw this in Jared's talk, is a function of variation in the genotype or in the genome sequence of an individual and variation in the environment. And as a geneticist, I'm interested in separating out this genotypic effect from any effects of the environment that may be idiosyncratic, right? So we want to know, we want to be able to, one of the goals of my research is to be able to predict phenotype on the basis of genotype. Of course, we also want to incorporate this environmental effect to the extent that we can, but that's more complicated and involves growing, for example, trees in multiple environments and measuring them in order to quantify those effects. These varying traits can have either simple or complex underlying genetic architectures. So if you remember Mendel from your high school biology, or if you took genetics at higher levels, he studied traits that had a fairly simple relationship between genotype and phenotype, sort of one-to-one. We call those, not surprisingly, Mendelian traits. Whether that was the color of the pods of his peas, the colors of his flowers, dwarf versus normal size plants. And those traits tend to have a single gene underlying them. So you can make a very easy relationship between what your alleles are at that gene, what form of that gene you have, and what your outward phenotype or trait is going to be. However, most traits that we're interested in, ecologically or economically speaking, or in terms of human health, are what we call quantitative traits, or complex traits. And these traits typically exhibit continuous distributions in the values that you measure. So for example, height, okay? There's not two categories of human height, there's 20,000 categories of human height, right? And that's where you get this sort of typical sort of bell curve that you might see. Disease resistance in plants is often Mendelian, but not always, and I think that blight, I know that blight resistance in chestnut is an example of a disease phenotype that is approaching a complex trait, certainly not simple. Understanding the genetic underpinnings of these traits, the parts of the genome that are contributing to variation in blight resistance, we can do that at several levels. Okay, you can have what we might call coarse-scale quantitative trait locus mapping. Quantitative trait locus is just a fancy word for here's the spot in the genome that causes differences in that trait. Okay, so we can use a sort of conventional method of making controlled crosses, measuring traits, measuring the genome in order to identify, very broadly speaking, locations in the genome that are relevant to that trait. Okay, that's called QTL mapping. We can do something else that's called association mapping, which is basically the same idea, except instead of making controlled crosses and measuring traits and the genome, we're just looking in natural populations, whether that's natural populations of humans or natural populations of trees. We're measuring at a much higher density the genome, and we are also measuring the trait just like we were before, and getting a sort of finer resolution over those traits and the relationship with the genetic and their underlying genetics. But the idea is the same, the population is different, and the implications for how we can use that data are different. The reason the implications for how we can use that data are different is because of what happens during the course of an individual's germline cells becoming pollen and ovule or sperm and egg or whatever, and that is recombination. So in the course of meiosis, we have sort of a mixing of the two homologous chromosomes, so that instead of having all blue and all green here, we have a chunk of blue on here and a chunk of yellow on here. And this mixing over many generations results in a mosaic of sort of blocks of the chromosomes that were inherited and recombined over many generations, such that we need to get, when you have lots of this recombination, we need to get fairly close to the location in the genome that is actually causing the difference in order to pick up a relationship between genotype and phenotype. And you'll see what I mean a little more later. I say that blight resistance is a complex trait, and that's manifested in the data from Fred and others at TACF over the years, showing that there's this kind of continuous distribution in canker size. If this was a very simple trait with a simple underlying genetic architecture, say one or two or even three genes, I might get in trouble here. You would expect to see discrete categories, say no blight, little medium blight, dead, you know? But we don't see that. And so I think that there's not only not one gene, but I think there's probably more than three that are involved. And that's where the kind of work that we're doing comes in. So you might have heard that there was, you know, there was three genes that are controlling blight resistance, and that was the assumption that Jared used in order to make those complex ABCD plots, right? But he also alluded to the fact that it might be more than three. And I think this is probably the case. Back in 97, Fred and others identified a number of QTL, these quantitative trait locus, basically genes for blight resistance, in their hybrid population. This is just a cartoon, basically, of the different chromosomes in the population and where they found those particular genes that were responsible for variation in blight resistance. Those are real, I'm sure of it. But, well, I can't say that for sure. I don't have any reason to believe that they're not real. But there are problems with this kind of study that are well known. The studies are still worth doing, and they still tell us a lot, but there are some limitations, especially when you have because you generally have relatively small numbers of small population sizes. This leads to an overestimation of the effect size. So they found in the original paper 42% of the variation in blight could be explained by these three QTLs. So that might be an overestimate. I heard 75% somewhere else, but I'm not sure what the relationship is there. So these effects can be overestimated. These intervals are just chunks of the genome. It's not like they found, you know, this is the exact location where blight resistance is encoded. They found some very broad interval across the genome where everything is correlated, and they said this chunk of the genome contains some factor for blight resistance. But in order to hone in on the particular location, you need to do a lot more work, a lot more process, do the study again in larger populations that have had more recombination, more generations, and so on. Okay, so even if these are three true blight QTLs, they're such large intervals that they could encompass more than one gene, each of them, right? So you could be looking at one gene here in each of these locations, or you could be looking at three or five. And the only way to discover that is by doing further work. So I said the effects are overestimated, and also 42% is not 100%, right? So there's other stuff that was not found in this kind of study. Those would be things that tend to have smaller effects on the phenotype, but are important nonetheless. Indeed, they contribute almost 60% of the variation in blight resistance. And we want to know about those because we want to get to 100%. Okay, so assuming that this is a complex trait, our goal is to shift the distribution of this population from its present status with respect to blight resistance to some new status that is enhanced. So how do we do that? Well, you've heard about phenotypic selection, and this is the way that plant breeding, plant animal breeding has proceeded for many years, and it works. It's very time-consuming. It involves screening large numbers of progeny in the case of plants in common gardens. We need to grow them. In the case of trees, it's even more of a hassle because you've got to usually wait years for the phenotype to develop, in the case of chestnut, to be able to score blight resistance. So this is time consuming. If we have a simple Mendelian trait or a trait that is only controlled by a couple or maybe three genes, we might be able to do what we call marker-gated selection, where we identify those particular regions of the genome with very high resolution, so we know pretty much the gene that is controlling the variation. Then we can take that into any population and say, okay, you have this form of this gene, you're gonna have whatever phenotype I'm interested in. That's marker-gated selection, and that's being used. But for traits that are encoded by a large number of loci, this doesn't really work, because finding all the specific location of tens or hundreds of QTLs is difficult or impossible, especially when a lot of them have very, very small effects on the phenotype. Okay, and so that's where this genomic selection comes in, where we want to screen a large number of bits of the genome and use those as variables that would predict the outcome, the phenotypic outcome, specifically blight resistance. Okay, so I kind of already alluded to this next slide. Phenotypic selection works, but it's slow, especially with progeny testing. Marker-rated selection, we need to know the precise locations of all of the genes, or at least a large proportion of them, and that's difficult or impossible depending on the study system. Genomic selection should be faster and should work well. And when I gave this a very similar talk at the annual meeting last year, I didn't have an answer to the should work well part of it, but today I think I do. Okay, so how is this going to work? Basically, we have some location in the genome illustrated by this little star here that is the location that determines blight resistance. If you have two of them, you're really good. If you have one of them, you're okay. And if you have none of them, you're not great. We don't know where that is. And so we can't directly measure it. But what we can do is measure densely enough across the whole genome so that we capture other variable bits that are close enough to it that they would be highly correlated with it. And so we're gonna measure this location in the genome right here that is also variable and linked to the blight resistance locus. And we're gonna use those bits as variables that would predict phenotype. Okay, this is just considering a single gene, but in genomic selection, we're considering the whole genome. But ultimately, what we want to get at is this relationship between genotype, where we have three possibilities, little a, big A, little a, big A, big A, and there's some nice relationship between them. I'm going to skip this one. Okay, so this just further illustrates that point, that in this kind of work, whether it's QTL mapping, like I was talking about before, or whether it's genomic selection, we're not actually capturing the locations in the genome that are causing variation in the trait. We're capturing variation in the genome that's close enough to it that what you have at this location is highly correlated with what you have at that location. That's a thing called linkage disequilibrium. Okay, so you know, this is just an example of linkage disequilibrium generating a relationship that we can measure between genotype and phenotype for a single locus. But we want to do this across all of the locations in the genome, okay? And how do we do that? Okay, so we've been doing this kind of measurement of single or handfuls of genetic loci for a long time, since the early 80s. Or before even. But how can we do this across the entire genome? And that wasn't possible until fairly recently with this so-called next generation sequencing. This is an example of one of the machines that we use. These are typically purchased by core facilities because they cost millions of dollars and they come up with a new one every 6 months. And so you wouldn't want to be buying one of these on a grant or something because you'd be basically bleeding money up into the thing. And you can just send it to somebody and have it be their responsibility to send the data back to you. This is the appliance that goes inside of this machine where our samples go. We take our DNA that we've prepared in a way that I'll show you in a minute. We inject it into what's called a flow cell. These are the lanes of the flow cell for obvious reasons, each of these little tubes here. And then a variety of magic happens in here and we get our sequence back. I'll tell you a little bit about that magic. The reason that sequencing has become so cheap in recent years is because of these next generation sequencers. So they give us a great deal of data for not a lot of money. Okay. So when the human genome was published in this is the cost for a single human genome. Okay. When the human genome was published in 2001, that if you wanted to sequence your genome, it would cost you $100 million or more. Okay. The Human Genome Project itself costs about $3 or $4 billion. Okay. Today I can sequence any of your genomes if you're interested. For a couple of $1,000s, okay, and give you a very good result, and that's because the amount of data you get from these kind of sequencers is so much greater than what you got from the previous generation, what so-called Sanger sequencing. Okay, so But we can't afford to sequence every spot in the genome of every chestnut tree that we want to. But we're talking about it. But for now, we're not. We're going to say that, that it's a bit too expensive. It's not outside of the realm of possibility. So what we need to do is to do something that we call genome complexity reduction. Genomes have a small bit of information in the form of genes, and a large piece of information in the form of repetitive DNA and so-called junk DNA that basically doesn't have, a lot of it does not have any functional consequence. So why would you want to spend your money getting information on parts of the genome that are not going to tell you anything about anything? Okay, that might be a bit strong, and probably in the future we're going to find more about what's going on in those regions outside of genes, but for now let's say that they're not useful. Understanding that, we might want to use our resources more wisely and sequence a smaller portion of the genome that might tell us as much as we need to know about the traits that we're interested in. So this genome complexity reduction refers to preparing a subset of the genome in some reproducible way. That's sort of a general description of it. So different options for that genome complexity reduction. This is not a genome complexity reduction. This is just whole genome sequencing. We can do that. Cost money. Cost by their money. We can do what's called RNA-seq. So we can sequence the result of the synthesis of genes into proteins, basically. An intermediate step called the messenger RNA. So we can sequence all of the genes that way. There are some problems with that, and for those reasons that I won't get into, we tend to not do it that way. We can do something called genotyping by sequencing, which is kind of a poorly worded term, but basically what it amounts to is chopping up the genome into little bits, isolating a subset of those bits, and then sequencing those bits. We can also do something called sequence capture, and I'm not sure if Jared mentioned this, but the idea here is that we can, if we know the sequence of a genome for an American chestnut tree, we can identify all the genes in that sequence. We can have a company synthesize these little bait sequences that we can use to retrieve those genes out of the genome, out of a sample prep of the genomic DNA. This is kind of expensive to make those baits, but it's nice because it allows you to decide, you know, okay, I think that blight resistance resides on a gene somewhere, okay? So I don't want to sequence anything that's not a gene. And 95% of the genome is not a gene. It's just all this random junk DNA. So I can design these baits that will capture those genes. So that could be a useful way to go about things. However, for what I'm talking about today, which might change how we go about this in the future, we're using GBS. Because it's fairly inexpensive, and at the beginning of this project, we didn't have very much money to do it, okay? So we still don't have very much money to do it, in case you have a checkbook. So the idea with this is that we use these things called restriction enzymes. These are just little enzymes that we isolate that can be isolated from bacteria. You buy them from a company. They cut DNA at a very particular sequence, A, C, T, G, C, C, whatever, right? In a very particular way, okay? And so the genome is littered with these very short sequences just by chance, these very short restriction sites just by chance. So when we subject a genome to digestion with these restriction enzymes, they get chopped up in such a way, and we can isolate, a fragment size range that we're interested in sequencing. So in this case, if we cut with two enzymes, black and gray X, we might then get a profile where we get a little short fragment here, a little longer here, a little short here, longer, and so on, everything that's between an X and an X. And then we want to capture things that are of a certain size range, say 300 to 500 base pairs, and so we can isolate those in a variety of ways so that we only sequence the things that are coming out in red here. And even though we're not capturing all or even most of the genome, for a variety of reasons that I won't get into, this is probably enough to capture the variation that we're interested in. And we go through a number of additional steps to prepare this DNA to be sequenced. We need to add these little fragments on the ends called adapters, which is what grabs onto the flow cell, and then allows that fragment to be sequenced. This is what the sequencing reaction looks like. We're basically identifying individual DNA sequence through fluorescence, called sequencing by synthesis, because a new strand of DNA is being built at each base, and so that's the way that we can identify what particular base is present at any particular location. And so here's the flow cell again. This is somebody's finger, by the way. So that's just like about the size of a little glass, slide. Here is one particular location of the flow cell blown up, and here's one particular location of that particular location blown up, and here is what's going to give us one of our sequences. Okay. So one of the things about this is that it's random. Okay. So we prepare our DNA in such a way that we have some fragment size range. That is sampled from the genome somewhere. We're sequencing it on this sequencer that basically identifies these clusters by its camera and knows that this is an individual piece of DNA, but it has no other information about it. It just knows that it's trying to get the information that's present in this little 300 base pair piece of DNA, and it's going to give you that in a file that you couldn't open in any kind of software if you wanted to, because it's so big. Okay, and you've got to do something with that. Namely, you've got to make sense of it. You've got to relate it back to the sequence of the chestnut genome, and you've got to use it in whatever way is useful to you. Okay, one of the things that's critical about this is that we can put more than one sample on a given flow cell lane. So this flow cell lane costs about $2,400. Okay, one of these lanes. So if we were to fill up this entire flow cell, it would be about $20,000. Okay. A lot of money, but we can put, through multiplexing, we can put 96 chestnut samples into an individual lane, and then we can computationally pull them apart so that we know that this set sequence came from this sample and that sequence came from that sample. Okay, so for $2,400, I can get you sequence data on 96 chestnut trees, and so on. So it's a lot of money in a way, but it's also not that expensive when you think about the way the other the other things we might be doing to advance this goal of getting blight-resistant chestnuts. Okay, so like I said, we can put about 96 samples in a single lane, cost a couple thousand dollars. We can prepare the DNA for sequencing for maybe $10, so I'm going to say that this costs maybe $30 per tree. Okay, but our goal is to get that price down, and we're thinking about different ways to do it. Actually, these days, this $10 is probably an overestimate. This doesn't seem to be changing. We've kind of flattened out in terms of the cost of sequencing curve that I showed you earlier. The companies keep coming out with new machines that give you more data, but the price is not going up as the amount of data. It used to be that they come up with a new machine, they give you X amount of data for price X, and then they would come up with a machine that gives you more data, and it would be the same price, so you're getting more data per cent or whatever, per dollar. But now it's kind of like, oh, we're going to give you more data, but we're going to increase the price of that individual lane. So this isn't getting any cheaper at this point. And there's been talk about a lot of different new technologies, sort of disruptive technologies that might be coming along with their, they all seem to be having problems, and nobody's really seen the results from those yet. So we're kind of stuck at this level for sequencing at this point. So what do we get from all this sequencing? We get mostly what we call single nucleotide polymorphisms. Those are the bread and butter of genetic variation. They're the reason that all of us look a little bit different. The main reason that all of us look a little bit different and have different trait values and so on, right? The reason that chestnuts look different. And what do we want to do with this? Well, we want to grab the phenotypic data that Jared and Fred and others have developed over the years. Couple that with the genotype data, the genome sequence data that we gathered, and we want to train a model that will predict the phenotype from the genotype. So we want to capture all of the variation that's relevant to blight resistance. In some cases, they'll chip the seed, just get a little bit of tissue off of the seed, run their model, and decide whether or not they even want to plant that seed.
This is just
and that's where you can get to.
Illustration of the advantages you might see in
for pine, this seems to be working fairly well, and this is one of the species, a lot of like pine, one of the species that's seen the most work on this, because it's obviously very important to timber production in the Southeast and the United States in general. We expect to see some nice relationship between the ability of our model to predict the phenotype and the call the narrow sense heritability. The narrow sense heritability is just the proportion of variation of the phenotype that we can attribute to genetics.
You can really shorten that.
So there's, going back to that original slide, the phenotype, genotype plus environment. This x-axis here is the genotypic component of variance. There's also an environmental component of variance. So for example, human height is about 90%, have the heritability over 90%. That means that knowing who your parents are will tell you pretty much how tall you're going to be within with some of their. The other 10% is environmental, and that can be like your nourishment as a child, for example. If you're malnourished as a child, you're going to not achieve your sort of genetic linkage. So this narrow sense heritability is the most we can hope to predict, and so that we should expect to see a nice relationship between our ability to predict and the value for narrow sense heritability. So as heritability goes up, our ability to predict goes up. There's more of a genetic component, but we're only predicting the genetic component at this point.
This seems to be working fairly well. This is one of the
another thing that we can do with these data is to track segments of the chromosomes in these back cross progeny that came from Chinese chestnut, that are unrelated to blight. And those are undesirable, right? We tend to focus a lot on finding trees that are blight resistant, obviously part of this process is also finding trees that are like chestnut, right? And so you could find a tree that is really super blight resistant, but it maybe doesn't have a phenotype, other phenotypes that are like American chestnut. So you wouldn't want that tree, even though it's great at resisting all blight. If you just wanted blight resistance, you could just go and plant Chinese chestnut plants. Of course, it would die because it would never get tall enough to capture enough light resources and outcomes.
The other 10% is environmental, and that can be like.
And so, coming back to that question of Mendelian versus complex traits, you might ask the question, okay, we've got all this genomic data. We know that there's at least three QTL, but he said there's probably more. Okay, why don't we just find those rest of them? Use those individual locations in the genome for our prediction rather than using the whole genome. One of the problems with that is illustrated by one of the problems with that is illustrated by the human studies of human height, where up until say 5 to 7 years ago, they had done these kinds of association studies where they're looking at individual markers and their relationship to height. And they were able to find DNA markers that explained about 5% of human height variance. And so that leaves something like 70 or 80% of human height that is unexplained by these studies.
Super blight resistant, but maybe it doesn't.
Where is all that variation? Why can't we find it if we can sequence an entire genome and sequence hundreds of individuals' entire genomes? Right? That's a phenomenon called the missing heritability.
Just wanted blight resistance.
One of the reasons, probably, is that evolutionary adaptation, may follow this what we call a geometric model. Okay. The idea here is that when you begin to move towards an optimum phenotype, maybe it's being very tall, right? You have at the beginning opportunities for a few big jumps that make you quite a bit taller right initially, right? But as you get closer to that optimum in the center here, the number of possible ways that you can drastically improve your phenotype decreases. Okay, so you start doing kind of fine-tuning, right? You get a little bit taller and a little bit taller, and as you get closer to that optimum, maybe it's 7 feet tall. At each step, now you're only adding 0.1 inch instead of 1 inch, right? And those things, as we get towards that optimum, we've accumulated all of these genetic mutations that have allowed us to reach that optimum. Some of them have a large effect, and as a geneticist, I can discover those easily. Some of them have an extremely tiny effect, and I can't distinguish those from the background of everything else that's in the genome. And so when folks started thinking about this missing heritability, one group decided, well, let's just, instead of trying to find those individual locations in the genome that tell you about human height or blight resistance, let's just take the whole genome as a predictor for human height or blight resistance and see where that gets us. And indeed, that gets them most of the way to the heritability of height. In fact, they can explain up to, in this case, up to 40% of variation in their population by taking the whole genome as variables that might tell you something about human height and using it, and not trying to distinguish the effects of individual locations in the genome. Okay, so that's a long-winded way of saying that I don't have a lot of data yet. But here's some analysis that I did. Actually, we have a lot of data. We're just trying to think about how to analyze it. We have sequenced actually about 750 chestnut trees in this way so far, through library preparation, and then put them on the sequencer, spend some money, and then we get our data back. We separate those samples out that were in the same lanes together, and run through some quality control analysis where we sort of try to put the puzzle together with respect to where those individual fragments came from in the genome. And then we want to be able to say this tree has this particular genetic sequence and that tree has that particular genetic sequence at the sites that are variable in our population. That leads us to about 405,000 data points. Which are those individual locations in the genome that are variable among individuals in the population, the so-called single nucleotide polymorphisms. Those are just the typical mutations that you think about when you think about a genetic mutation, which I do a lot. But with GBS, we have a problem of missing data, okay? So we may have a total of 405,000 SNPs, but if I say I only want the SNPs where I was able to get information on 50% of the trees and that have a frequency greater than 1 in 100 samples, I only have like 15,000. And so this is enough, but we still would like to not, we'd like to have a matrix that doesn't have this missing data. The good news is that populations like the B3, F2, and F3 are structured in such a way that they lend themselves to inferring what that missing data is based on what's around it. And that's because of the level of linkage disequilibrium and other factors that I won't get into. But so even though we have a lot of missing data in this data set, we can basically infer what the genotype of an individual should be based on what that individual has around it in its genome sequence. Okay, so what do we do now that we have all this data set ready to go? We have the phenotypes, we have the genotypes for say 20,000 SNPs. We computed the missing data. What we want to do is run a model where we split the population of trees into a training data set and a testing data set or validation data set. We want to fit a model that takes the genome sequence as a predictor for the phenotype, basically using the genotype and the phenotype in order to identify a model that's going to best fit our data. We're going to use that model to predict the blight resistance of the set that wasn't used to make the model. Okay. Otherwise, we run into a problem called overfitting. We can get a really great model. I can do a really good job of predicting the trees that I used to make the model. But the idea is to predict trees that weren't involved in the model making process. So we do this many times to determine what the error in the model building process is, and I did an additional check where I basically randomized the phenotypes and did this again. So instead of having in the initial case, I have this nice relationship which you would expect between here's the genome sequence of tree X and here's its phenotype. Well, there I get a nice result from that, but I wanted to know if that was, you know, to what extent that might have happened at random. And so I take those phenotypes and I kind of mix them all up so that I've broken the relationship between the genome sequence and the phenotype. And I should get a very bad result from that analysis, which is indeed the case. So this is just a plot showing the mean values for the measured blight resistance and the predicted blight resistance. Don't worry about the scale on the y-axis here. It's just as a result of the model fitting. It's not the same as the scale on the x-axis. But what we expect to see is a nice positive relationship between the blight score that Jared or Fred has measured and the blight score that the model predicts. And so indeed, we do see a nice relationship here. There's some scatter around it, but we see a positive relationship. When I randomize those blight scores, I expect to see no relationship because I'm basically feeding the model garbage. And in fact, that's what I get, okay? How much of the variance does this explain? Our predicted ability for the when we do the model building the proper way is about 20%. So we can the correlation between the measured phenotypes and the predicted phenotypes is about 20%, which is about as much as you can hope for given the current population that we're using. For the random phenotypes where I broke the model, it's zero, which is what you would expect. So this tells me that we're getting a positive signal from the genomic data that is related to the phenotype data in a real way. So this is going to be potentially useful going forward. So at present, we sequenced about 750 trees. In going through, starting out his position, Jared reanalyzed some of the data, and he found the heritability is a little low for the population that we're currently working with. Part of that is due to measuring phenotypes of individual trees versus using progeny testing to determine the genetic worth of a tree. And so going forward, we're going to switch our focus to those trees that Jared talked about, which are in the progeny test pipeline. So we can get a really good measurement of the genetic worth of those individual trees, and then we can feed them into our genotyping pipeline, and we can feed them into our model, and we can develop a really robust statistical framework that will, going forward, be able to predict de novo phenotypes of trees that you all might have in orchards across the state, across the country. Oh, I had this slide earlier, yeah. I wanted to test this out even though we're moving on to something else. So it seems to be working, and I'm excited to continue this enterprise. This is an old acknowledgement slide from when I was giving this talk at Forest Health Initiative meetings. This is a consortium some of you may have heard of that is mostly involved in Bill Powell's transgenic GM chestnut work. And I was involved in that because, as a token geneticist in a project that was at Virginia Tech where we were planting on old coal mine sites, which is of interest to Duke Energy, one of the funders. Anyways, so these folks have all provided funding in addition to TACF, who's supporting a research assistant in our lab. This Forest Health Initiative, and of course, the folks at the American Chestnut Foundation would not be possible without them. So thanks.
So Bill Powell and Chuck Maynard from the State University of New York in Syracuse took a gene from wheat, which is called oxalate oxidase. So chestnut blight fungus produces a lot of this chemical called oxalate, and that is involved in affecting it causes some of the cankering. So it affects the way the plant responds to the chestnut blight fungus. And this gene from wheat basically takes this oxalate that the fungus is producing in abundance and neutralizes it, turns it into carbon dioxide and hydrogen peroxide. So Bill Powell was sort of lucky in making a guess that this gene from wheat that's involved in resistance to wheat rust fungus would also be important for chestnut blight resistance. So he's taken this gene and inserted it into chestnut embryos through this process where he takes bacteria that take this gene as a carrier and move it in and actually insert it into the genome of the American chestnut. And then they, once they generate these trees as embryos, they've been able to grow them up and cross those trees with Native American American chestnuts that are susceptible to disease. And this is a single gene that confers resistance. So the inheritance of that is simple. One half of the progeny are going to inherit it, one half are not, on average. So those individuals that inherit the gene from this cross have very small cankers. And those individuals that did not inherit the gene are susceptible as American chestnut. So this simplifies the whole game a lot, because you can have one single gene with a major effect, you can take that transgenic tree, cross it with basically any American chestnut tree that you find flowering in the forest, half of those trees are going to inherit the gene. We don't have to screen hundreds of progeny to figure out, we don't have to do genomic selection. We just simply cross these transgenic trees with American chestnuts from throughout the range. So this is not necessarily going to replace back cross breeding, but what it's going to do is augment the whole program. So we're going to take potentially if this tree is allowed for release, it's currently being reviewed by the U.S. Department of Agriculture, the Food and Drug Administration, the EPA. If they find that this insertion of this gene does not affect the growth of the tree, it doesn't affect the ecological relationships with beneficial fungi, with pollinators. They're doing a whole series of different experiments to show that basically this gene is involved in blight resistance. It doesn't really affect anything else, but it confers blight resistance. So if they're successful in getting that through deregulation process, then we should be able to identify areas of the whole range of the American chestnut species where perhaps we haven't sampled in our back cross breeding program. And we can take basically all of the diversity that remains, all of the adaptive genetic diversity in those populations that are sitting in sprouts now, and we can cross that in with the transgenic tree and basically capture all the adaptive variation that we need in order to basically rescue the species. There's an opportunity going forward with genomics as well to be able to identify where in the region, where in the whole species range is the adaptive variation located. It's not necessarily evenly located up the whole range of the species. The south is where, when the glaciers came down, the tree contracted, the range of the species contracted down to the southern region of the United States, and it was existing in refugia in the south. And so those areas the southern region has more genetic diversity. So we may use genomics to identify where, which counties, which particular microclimates or elevations or whatever is important for adaptation, and to bring those trees from the forest into germplasm conservation orchards that we can easily cross them with the transgenic tree to incorporate additional genetic diversity. So, that's one way, and I think we're going forward as an organization is prioritizing more effort on conserving important and rare genetic diversity that's important for adaptation for the purpose of when this tree gets deregulated to be able to incorporate that diversity into the breeding program. So the idea here is you take this transgenic tree, cross it with regionally adapted, you get 50% of the trees that are going to be resistant to the disease, and you can generate multiple progeny from each of these crosses to sample different portions of the genome from each of those individual regionally adapted American chestnuts and basically capture all of the diversity that particular tree has to offer in multiple progeny. And then we can continue to cross these trees together to create a founder population that has sufficient diversity to survive on its own. The other exciting thing that the transgenic tree offers potential, there's a merger of the back cross breeding program with the transgenic program, is we have resistance to this second pathogen, Phytophthora cinnamomi, which is thought to have extirpated the American chestnut from the low-lying peat-moss regions of the southeastern United States primarily prior to the introduction of the chestnut blight. So this Phytophthora was introduced into North America from Europe well before chestnut blight, so in the 1800s, 1700s. And basically Chinese chestnut happens to be resistant to that disease. And we were lucky in the sense that, even though we weren't selecting for resistance to this pathogen, it just so happens that by chance, some of these hybrids that we generated inherited the resistance to Phytophthora root rot. And it seems that we've been doing some screening, and it seems that resistance to Phytophthora is controlled by major effect genes. So in the absence of any previous selection for resistance to Phytophthora root rot in this Graves source of resistance, we see that some trees have resistance that approaches that of Chinese chestnut. Compare that to chestnut blight, where we've been doing intense selection for many, many years, and we're still not seeing very high, as high levels of resistance we're seeing for this to Phytophthora root rot. So that suggests that there's some major genes involved in resistance to Phytophthora. And so it's when you have major genes involved in resistance, it should be relatively more straightforward to cross that those trees that have high resistance to Phytophthora with the transgenic tree that has high resistance to blight, and to combine the resistance to both pathogens in a relatively straightforward manner. And we can use the genomics to identify, just like what Jason was talking about, we can identify regions and predict Phytophthora resistance just as we can do for chestnut blight. Wow, this animation's weird. So basically what we would do is we would cross the transgenic trees with trees that are resistant to Phytophthora, and then we potentially intercross these trees in order to enhance the resistance to Phytophthora further, while also having this resistance that's conferred by the oxalate-oxidase gene. And so we're basically, in a couple of generations, we're able to combine resistance to both pathogens in a straightforward manner. So I think, going forward, opportunities for citizen science. We still are in the process of planting seed orchards. We're still in the process of inoculating and doing progeny testing to develop these genomic selection prediction models. So there's, that's going to be a large effort in the next 5 to 10 years. Or if you want to volunteer, we'd be glad to have you work with us at the Meadowview Research Farms and work in the Virginia chapter planting seed orchards. Another way is if you can find flowering American chestnuts in the forest. And that would be useful for us. We could go out, identify those trees, make sure they are truly American chestnuts, and then breed those and make sure we bring that material back into germplasm conservation orchards. And so there's still opportunity, and then of course you can visit our website and donate to the American Chestnut Foundation to help fund some of the work for genomics as well. So there's a lot of work involved in growing these trees and screening them. So the work, in a broad sense, we're paying for. It's not me doing, when the people are giving me credit for doing the screening. It's Emily and Brandon and the people that work at the farm that are doing a lot of this screening, and it's an expensive thing that we have to do every year. So any donation that you give to us would be very helpful. So that's all I have to say, and thank you for Jason and Anna for giving much more detailed talks on their areas.
So
yeah, I'm Dick Olson with the Virginia branch. Jason, on your first set of slides, the last slide, you were showing bar charts and demonstrating with bar charts, and it was demonstrating the advantage of incorporating the genomics. What were those percent? You had percent field testing percent.
Yeah. So the So this is simulated data, so it's not Jason was providing you real estimates of how accurate the genomic models are, but basically the idea is that we're still going to be growing trees. We're still going to be doing inoculating trees and calling out 90% of the individuals based on the phenotype. So doing this early screening methods will help out a lot with that process. So we're talking about doing the initial selection of 90% selection intensity. So we're going to, so if we grow out 30,000 trees, we're going to uproot all but 3,000. And then, so we're left with 3,000, we want to get down to 300. It would be a massive effort to progeny test 3,000 trees. So we're talking about growing up 30 progeny, 30 to 50 progeny for each of these 3,000 trees. We're talking, 90,000 trees that we, and that's more than we could possibly grow and screen. So we would progeny test maybe 500 trees per source of resistance. So that is like 30,000 trees that we're talking, or less, 15,000 trees per source of resistance. That's more manageable, we can do that. And then we use that information to do genotyping on the remaining 8% of the population. So 90% phenotypic selection, maybe 2% progeny testing, which is the really massive effort. And then the remaining trees that are left over that we haven't done any progeny testing on, we would do the DNA sequencing on, and we would, and that's what's gonna give us the gain per unit time. It's gonna shorten them. We don't have to progeny test so many trees. We can just do the DNA sequencing on. So the gain, we're expecting that the genomic models will be even more accurate in some ways than progeny testing, because we're capturing all of this information on the relatedness in these populations, and it should enhance our accuracy. At the same time, it should save us a bunch of time, because we're not having to plant out so many trees for progeny tests.
My name's Tom Weil, I'm also from the Virginia chapter, and I guess my question's for Anne. Since you don't really know the source of all the compounds, the compound variations that you're testing for, you alluded to the idea that you might have to control for environmental factors like what time of year you take the sample.
Things, but how do you control for all the other environmental factors, soil chemistry, how cold the winter was, all of those things I would think sort of pile into there. So some environmental factors you can easily get your hands on, and others, at least until you know what that compound variation is across a really wide population. I don't know how you do that.
So that's a good point. There's a lot of different environmental factors that could impact things like chemistry. Now, I don't have any specific data to say, like, soil chemistry, for instance, isn't going to have an impact on, like, the chemicals that we're analyzing. But I think that it's probably unlikely that a factor like that would affect the individual chemicals present, maybe the amount. But the idea would, not only would you need to, you know, select a certain time of the year, find out whether or not there's within year variation in the chemicals, but have multiple years of data. So you can build these models by analyzing lots of samples over time and essentially try to come up with a predictive model that takes into account all those factors in the background. So you're not really specifying them, but you're taking into account by having a lot of samples sampled over lots of times. So it's obviously not something that you can just do, develop in like a matter of days or weeks. I mean, yes, you can develop one model in that time, but you need to test it. And Jason talked a lot about validation, and that same is true for this type of technique as well. So that's something that you would definitely need to take into consideration.
Hi, I'm Bruce Levine from the Maryland chapter. Question for Ann again also. You said earlier that you had some promising results. Could you elaborate a little bit on that? Like how promising? I'm just trying to get a sense of how predictive this technology can be.
So I showed the example of the Clapper data set. And so, I mean, that was only from about, I think, 40 or 50 individuals. So it's a really small number of individuals from about 10 different families. And so we are able to find that there was a strong correlation between the actual measured lesion length and the one that was predicted based on our chemical fingerprint data. Granted, that was like an optimized model, so we removed like outliers, most of actually which came from that intermediate group, which we're not so much interested in the intermediate, right? We want to know the extremes. So, I mean, that's promising because we see that there's a strong positive correlation. And while we weren't able to validate that on another data set, we used a method called cross-validation, which is a different type of math that allows you to be a little bit more confident in the model that you build without testing it on another set of samples. So that's very promising. However, we weren't able to see the same type of relationship with our Graves data set, but we had a very low sample size. So I'm sure as many of you know, like 40 or 50 chestnut trees, like that's pretty small numbers. So that's promising, but we need to test it on more individuals, maybe more individuals per family, and try to tease apart maybe some of those differences, like different sources of genetics that may be in fact impacting the chemical fingerprint and creating models that are appropriate for different groups of either different families or individual families, whatever we find works the best.
Hi, Josh Gravani with Virginia Chapter. So in the chapter breeding program, at least, we produce the intercrosses with open pollination. So with these new techniques, would there be an advantage to go into controlled pollination to make those intercrosses?
I don't think so, because it's gonna increase the linkage disequilibrium in the population. And it's gonna, if we train models on a controlled pollination population, they're gonna be less transferable to other populations. It's gonna introduce sort of population-specific signatures that are difficult to translate, I think.
And the other thing is, when you do controlled pollination, you're not gonna get as many individuals per family. It's gonna be a lot more work, and you know, there's probably more than three genes involved in resistance, so ideally we would screen more per family in order to enhance resistance further. So potentially if we could increase the throughput of these pipelines using these early screening techniques and then add addition of genomic selection, we might be able to even increase our selection intensity further. We need to have more individuals per family to do that. So open pollination is more efficient.
Good. President Hubbard, you talked about me. Within a family, if you test resistance, do the genomic selection, would your predictions be more accurate than predictions obtained from a random sample?
For that family. But for anything else, it would be pretty useful.
Right. And then that would also apply to open pollinated sampling of specific open pollinated families.
It depends how diverse the sampling is, I guess.
So you analyze on a specific family basis.
I'm analyzing across families.
Right.
So that's all that variation.
Right. But I'm saying, likewise, for the control population sample, if you analyze on family by family basis, that might be more accurate within the family.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if that was a goal, yeah.
I mean, it would depend on, you know, how satisfied you are with the accuracy.
Exactly.
One of the questions that sort of remains within this whole line of research is, we're developing these genomic prediction models with material from Meadowview, Virginia. Which has a certain...
Oh yeah, that's another fact.
we have certain American parents that are used in the model. We don't expect that the American parents should contribute to blight resistance, but the genetic background of those Americans may be contributing to the accuracy of the models. So the question is, are those models transferable to Virginia Chapter or Maine or North Carolina, which has, you know, they are related in the sense that they share some pedigree relationships with the Meadowview material, but they have different American parents in the later generations, and so they're less related. So we're gonna be developing genomic selections at Meadowview to complete selections at Meadowview, but will those models also be transferable to help speed up the selection process in the entire breeding program from Alabama all the way up to Maine? And those individuals are not going to be as related as closely related as MetaView is with MetaView trees, they're going to be maybe at most like cousins, first cousins. Versus MetaView, you have siblings. So that might reduce the predictive ability of the models.
Carl, Action, Virginia chapter. All these trees you're testing are really immature trees. Is there anything to indicate that the resistance will remain consistent throughout the life of that tree, or even increase or decrease?
Not yet. We don't have the evidence yet. We have what we call sparse progeny tests that are being installed to answer that question. All of these tests were done in the orchard under artificial inoculation. Hopefully with the forest progeny test we can begin to see the effect of this resistance in the natural setting on a naturally occurring population. And I might add that the forest progeny test thus far indicate that many of the families are as good as American chestnut in terms of growth rate and form.
So my question, I'm Hill Craddock from Chattanooga. My question is sort of a follow-up from the chapter standpoint. We are engaged now in establishing our seed orchards, which is a huge effort. And I guess what I need to know from the genomics folks is, because of the urgency of doing this, is there some suggestion to us, should we stay the course? Or do we adapt or
stay the
change
course.
Our protocol now in terms of what you know our planning and
I would suggest that if you what you're doing with the early screen at Chattanooga continue to try that method to see if you can eliminate some of the trees before planting.
So that already changes a little bit. So rather than just collecting open pollinated seed and direct seeding it, we're going to run it through a container for a year or some amount of time and try and kill half of them or more.
Yeah.
Well, you're still waiting for validation of that technique for
right.
3 years.
So meanwhile, my back cross orchards are perishing.
Meanwhile, don't stop.
Yeah. So the lifespan of a back cross orchard is you know, they're aging and dying for lots of other reasons besides chestnut blight and phytophthora. And so I feel like there's this critical urgency to do, you know, to get the seed orchard established as soon as possible. And so I just...
Yeah, keep going with the seed orchards. And if you can figure out a way to do the screen, early screening up front, that would be good. And then wait for the genomic selection models, the validation of those models to see what we're going to do going forward.
It's not going to be ready for a little while yet. I mean, we got to wait for all the progeny test data to come online. To get it really...
4 years, right?
You're looking at 2020, right?
2020, I mean, if everything goes well on the farm, you know, and we can collect the numbers.
I mean, we could start looking at it before then, but, yeah. You know, I wouldn't want to be advising anybody on which trees are good and which trees are bad until I have really confident in that. To be confident, we need a large number of progeny tested trees that are sequenced and so on.
But that's not affecting you anyway. You're doing it right. As your back cross orchards mature and you can test them, you're screening them, you're making to your selections, you're not waiting to collect the open pollinated seeds. You're doing that. You're early screening them now, and you've already got your seed orchards in. By the time you've gotten through the early
selections, I don't think we have our seed orchards in. What I see is a lot of effort planting stuff. But I don't see a seed orchard yet. I see a lot of effort planting, but I'm not gonna admit that it's a seed orchard yet.
Are you talking about like one that you could produce blight-resistant trees?
Yeah, you're talking about a B3F2 plantation.
A B3F2.
When does it become a seed orchard?
And so you know, we planted thousands of nuts last year. I mean, actually, this spring. And then, guess what? It didn't rain for 9 months. And so, you know, if it doesn't rain, you know, they don't grow very much, let me tell you. So that effort was a waste. I mean,
mean, I think we've lost everything at Seven Islands.
No.
But if you kept a half a dozen, you've developed a drought resistant.
Ned Yost didn't introduce himself, but he's an awesome character, so we're glad he's here. I want to just address Bruce Levine's issue about cloning younger volunteers. I believe that Hippocratic started when he was 14 with Chestnut. I think you told me that. So you can see where the need is. But I would have to say that it's very heartening to me to see a younger generation of scientists who are willing and able to talk to folks who love science and are interested in Chestnut restoration. So it's really been great to have the three of you here presenting to us today. And I think that we can take this across the generations somehow. We, you know, a lot of us who are great worry about bringing younger people through the pipeline, but I'm really impressed with what we've produced. So thank you so much. Thanks everyone for coming.